Welcome to this presentation on experimental ultraviolet radiation exposure. My name is Paul Lomani. A written version of this presentation is due to be published in the Journal of Investigative Dermatology and will be linked in the description box when it is available. A brief introduction first. Ultraviolet radiation, or UVR, is a common technique often required in clinical and preclinical studies. This can range from calibrating light source outputs, irradiating cells, through to human studies perhaps assessing the phototoxic potential of a new drug. It is important to fully understand the characteristics of UVR and the principles behind correct and appropriate UVR exposure. This isn't just to ensure that the science is done properly and the results are reliable. This is also so that other people can understand exactly what it is that was done and replicate or adapt protocols as necessary. To start with, we will first define a few terms that are necessary to explain further concepts. The first term is power. In this context, power relates to the total optical output of the light source in all directions, measured in watts. This is not normally useful to report with non-coherent UVR exposures, as quite often not all of the light output from a source is incident on a sample, and it gives us no information on how that power is distributed. Instead, we most often use irradiance, which is the power falling on a surface per unit area, measured in watts per meter squared. It should always be reported alongside information on the spectral range to which it applies. For example, irradiance equals 10 watts per meter squared in the range of 280 to 400 nanometers, which gives that measurement a bit more context. Going further, we have the spectral irradiance, which is the irradiance per unit wavelength, measured in watts per meter squared per nanometer, normally displayed in graphical format. This should ideally be displayed on both logarithmic and non-logarithmic y-axes, for reasons that will become apparent in the next slide. Radiant exposure, measured in joules per meter squared, is often referred to as the dose. This is the most common measurement reported in UVR exposure studies. The radiant exposure is equal to irradiance multiplied by exposure time. Reciprocity is an important concept, and it is when the biological effects depend upon the radiant exposure only and not the way in which it was delivered. For example, the same biological effect from 10 joules per meter squared delivered as either 10 watts per meter squared in 1 second or 1 watt per meter squared in 10 seconds. Reciprocity cannot always be assumed, and shouldn't be assumed unless there is strong evidence to the contrary. Therefore, it is not sufficient to simply report radiant exposure. How the radiant exposure is delivered is just as important. Wavelength refers to a specific wavelength of light per nanometer, for example, 350 nanometers. And waveband defines a range of wavelengths, for example, 315 to 400 nanometers, though sometimes about a central wavelength, for example, 350 plus or minus 10 nanometers, with the plus or minus 10 nanometers referring to the full width half maximum of the light source output. So now that we have covered most of the relevant terms, we'll move on to talk about the UVR spectrum itself. UVR, from 100 to 400 nanometers, can be subdivided into a few different categories. UVA, from 315 to 400 nanometers, can itself be subdivided into UVA1 and UVA2. Also UVB, from 280 to 315 nanometers, and UVC, from 100 to 280 nanometers. Light sources are often referred to by their UV range, for example, a UVA lamp. And while this is quite convenient, that's not very specific, and it only gives you an idea of the range of the light source output, and not how the output is distributed across that range. And that's why the spectrum of a light source is essential, providing critical information on wavelength-dependent biological mechanisms. If we consider the spectrum of this light source, we can clearly see the shape of the source with two very obvious peaks around 315 and 365 nanometers. It can be important then to plot the logarithmic spectrum, where we can then see these smaller peaks towards a shorter wavelength range. This is important because very low UVR emissions at a given wavelength may be the cause of the biological effect if they are more effective than the higher UVR emissions at other wavelengths. Let's take the example of erythema. If we take this spectrum and we multiply it by the erythema action spectrum, what we find is that these lower wavelength peaks may often be more effective at producing erythema than the higher wavelength peaks that are more prominent in the spectral irradiance graph. Uniformity. It is important to measure uniformity of UVR distribution within the irradiation area. For example, I might measure the irradiance of a light source in the middle of this well plate at point A. But that doesn't give me any information about what the rest of the well plate is being exposed to. So, to measure the uniformity, I might take measurements at the four corners of the well plate. And now with these five measurements, I can get a variety of descriptive statistics about the UVR distribution across this well plate. The coefficient of variation, or COV, should be as low as possible, and the difference between any two measurements values should not be more than 10%. In this example, the maximum percentage difference is 3%, and the coefficient of variation is 1.06%. Safety is of course very important, as UVR can present a hazard to human health. Exposure limits for UVR are published by the International Commission for Non-Ionizing Radiation Protection, and these are summarized as follows. Ultraviolet radiant exposure incident upon the unprotected eyes should not exceed 30 joules per meter squared effective, spectrally weighted in the spectral region of 180 to 400 nanometers, and 10 to the 4 joules per meter squared unweighted in the spectral region of 315 to 400 nanometers, and both of these criteria must be met. Additionally, the first limit also applies to exposure incident upon the skin. So if we take the first point, the action spectrum that they refer to when weighting the spectrum can be found by the following formulae below. You can put these formulae into Excel sheet and it will give you the action spectrum that we are interested in. So as an example, if we take our light source from before, multiply it by the action spectrum we have just found, sum together all values to get the irradiance, and then divide that into 30 joules per meter squared, that would be radiant exposure divided by irradiance, and that would give us our maximum permissible exposure limit, which in this case is 24 minutes and 46 seconds. As both limits apply, we can similarly calculate the risk from the second point, and we find that the maximum permissible exposure limit is 3 minutes and 34 seconds, and we would always abide by the lower of these two values. The time presented here would be the maximum exposure duration in an 8-hour period. This is of course a limit, and all reasonable measures should be taken to reduce the amount of unnecessary UVR exposure. All UVR sources should initially be checked for non-UVR outputs and should be risk assessed accordingly. In the hierarchy of control measures, engineering controls are the preferred option, and these include the UVR being enclosed within a box or an interlock on the lab. Administrative controls can be put in place, including staff training and SOPs. And lastly, personal protective equipment such as UV protective glasses. While their use may be required, these should not be relied on as the only risk control measure. Moving on then to preclinical testing. When investigating the effects of UVR in cell culture models in vitro, endpoints that can be considered as indicators of the biological effects of UVR include the induction of cell cycle arrest or apoptosis, and the quantification of DNA damage. UV-induced DNA damage can be assessed by assessing DNA comets, or quantifying cyclobutane pyrimidine dimers, or CPDs, and 6-4 photoproduct formation. On the right, you can see a graphic showing DNA damage as a result of UVR exposure. The UV photon carries enough energy to break apart the bonds that hold DNA together. These may then form bonds within the same strand of the double helix, and it is these errors in the DNA that, if allowed to replicate, may then cause cancers. These can be detected using molecular, chromatographic, and mass spectrometry strategies. And they can be detected and quantified in animal models and human skin after UVR irradiation too. For preclinical drug testing, the regulatory requirements state that any drug absorbing light between 290 and 700 nanometers must undergo photosafety evaluation, with the first step being the in vitro 3T3 neutral red uptake phototoxicity test. This test is illustrated below. So we start with two well plates and we incubate our cells with varying concentrations of the drug of interest. One of these well plates is exposed to 5 joules per centimeter squared of UVA radiation, which is detailed in the reference below. The other is kept in the dark. Afterwards, the cells are rinsed, media is added, and they are allowed to incubate for a further 24 hours. After this, the neutral red is added. They are incubated for a further 3 hours, rinsed, and then fixed. The idea is that the viable cells that can still proliferate will take up more of the neutral red than the cells that have been damaged by the drug-light combination. In a spectrophotometer, we measure the optical density at 540 nanometers and use this to determine the IC50 for UVA and dark samples. We then calculate the photoirritation factor, and if the photoirritation factor is greater than 5, then the drug is classed as phototoxic. Appropriate controls should be in place for any study design. This may include at least 4 study arms: unirradiated cells with no drug applied, irradiated cells with no drug applied, unirradiated cells with drug applied, and irradiated cells with drug applied. Each arm of the study should be subject to the same variations in drug concentration and radiant exposure. On to clinical phototesting. Some of the key aspects of clinical phototesting are considering whether you would need a narrowband or a broadband source, whether you want to carry out single exposures or iterative testing, the dose ranges and irradiances to use, which will often be informed by the literature or prior preclinical tests, are normal range values available, which would depend on your study or patient population, and what are the endpoints of the study. The most common endpoint in clinical phototesting is the minimal erythemal dose. This is the minimum dose of a specified waveband of light that produces a visually perceptible reddening of the skin. There are variations between and within sources concerning visual or quantitative measurements of erythema, and these can include assessor training, ambient lighting conditions, and variability between measurement devices. When considering light sources, one type of light source is a narrowband light source. Narrowband phototesting is typically only available through specialist photodiagnostic centres and is usually carried out using an irradiation monochromator. Light from a broadband xenon arc lamp is filtered by a diffraction grating monochromator, allowing narrow and specific wavebands to be emitted and used to irradiate the skin. These specific wavebands may then be used to determine waveband-specific MEDs. It is important to have a normal population reference range when measuring MEDs across the UV spectrum, as it will allow deviations from the normal range of MEDs to be detected. Another type of light source is the solar simulator, which are typically broadband light sources. Despite the terminology, these light sources are often not a mimic of the solar spectrum, as is evident in the graph below. There are guidelines for solar simulators, but they do permit a large variance in the spectrum. These were not specifically designed with clinical phototesting in mind. As you can see from the reference at the bottom of the screen, the guidelines were designed with SPF measurement in mind. These light sources may be used either to define MEDs or as a provocation source. However, the MED determined will be specific to that light source. Filters may sometimes be used to remove certain wavebands, for example UVB, although residual exposure at certain wavelengths through the use of inefficient filters may confound results and create false positives. So that's a reminder here, as I mentioned before, to always look at the spectral irradiance and the logarithmic spectral irradiance too. Exposures from solar simulators, and sometimes other lamps, are often equated to daylight exposures, usually traceable to a midday Mediterranean sun, though a reference spectrum should always be provided if making this type of comparison. What is often missed, or at least not highlighted, is that there may be competing physiological responses at different wavelengths. You might often hear the phrase, N minutes in a sunbed is equal to X minutes in the midday sun. If you're going to carry out this type of comparison, it is absolutely crucial that you provide as much context as possible, such as the spectral irradiance of the light source and the daylight it is being compared to. Some notes on clinical phototesting. The skin's response to UV irradiation varies depending on the body site and the skin phototype, and is also influenced by chronic sun exposure. An MED on a sun-exposed site is typically higher than that on a non-exposed area. For example, an MED on the lower leg is on average 4 times higher than that on the trunk in lighter skin phototypes. Provocation should ideally be carried out on consistent body sites, usually the back, and on clear skin, to allow for interpatient comparison. Alternatively, it may be performed on a body site that is of particular interest, for example, where a rash is induced with natural exposure. Practical information should always be included in reporting, and caution should be exercised if comparing results to a normal range, which may have been derived using a different irradiation source, body site, or a different patient population. To conclude, UVR exposure can be carried out in a controlled and safe manner, and be wary of low yet biologically relevant UVR peaks in the spectrum. The best practices for preclinical and clinical phototesting have been outlined, with the importance of the choice of UVR source highlighted. Finally, context matters with MEDs. Report as much as possible and consider the endpoints of the study. I'd like to finish by acknowledging the team at the Photobiology Unit at Ninelows Hospital in Dundee.